When it comes to wireless audio systems, there's exactly one thing you need, and that is reliability. In today's video, I want to talk about the Shure GLXD wireless guitar system. I want to talk about why I think it's the most reliable and also the best value for your money wireless guitar system you can buy. So stay tuned. It doesn't really matter whether we're talking about wireless microphones, wireless in-ear systems, or wireless guitar systems. In the end, you need a reliable system. You don't want any dropouts, any noise. You don't want to have to worry about battery life. Your situation might be different if you're just playing guitar at home or in a practice room. Then you might get away with a more janky unit. But if you're playing on stage in a service, you want a reliable system. At least I don't want to do any experiments on stage. I want to know that the systems and the gear I'm using is reliable and it's not causing me any extra headaches, but it's actually enhancing what I do. So the last couple of months I've been searching for a wireless guitar system that would be reliable, but I was actually looking still for a more middle priced unit, and I was looking at all the systems by Sennheiser, by Line 6, and even the more cheap dongle stuff. And I kept reading reviews, watching YouTube reviews, and heard about all the kind of issues people were having. And I saw that some of the units don't really have a good battery indicator, so you never know when you run out of battery, or the build quality sucks and the belt packs kept breaking down or something like that. Or people were saying they were quite happy with a unit because it was working most of the time, but most of the time is not good enough for me. And the thing I kept getting back at was the Shure GLXD system. I kept reading all the good reviews. I was a little bit hesitant about the price, but in the end I thought I might give it a try. So this is the GLXD 1/6 unit. It consists of this pedal, which is the receiver, and the belt pack, that is this unit. And the first thing I want to talk about is build quality. So let's unplug this. This is the receiver pedal. It has a built-in tuner, two antennas right here, and a display. The whole unit is built like a tank. It's basically full metal construction. Really heavy. Of course, that doesn't really translate through video, but this is extremely solid build. I cannot imagine any way of this breaking down or having some serious kind of damage done to it. If we plug it in, you can see it has a display showing the current channel it operates on. And if we switch to tuner mode, I've not connected the guitar right now, but it would operate as a tuner. Yeah. And this right here is the belt pack. It's also all metal construction. And like the receiver pedal, this is extremely solid build. Even if I dropped this on the floor, I would probably not be worried too much about it. Even the belt clip on the back, it's very solid and strong. And even details like the opening for the battery, even that is built from solid metal. So yeah, big plus for the build quality. And that's probably not the main reason why I think this unit is extremely reliable, but it's definitely one reason. Now let's talk about how this unit operates. It's working on the 2.4 gigahertz wireless band. So that's basically the frequency range of a wireless router, a Wi-Fi system. Now I've used this system in a setting where we have a wireless router for live streaming our services, for example, and other wireless systems. And I didn't have any interference problems whatsoever. It worked great out of the box. This system operates on three channels of the 2.4 gigahertz band simultaneously. If one of the channels gets blocked or there's any interference, it switches in the background seamlessly. So the system will switch to the best channel on the Wi-Fi band automatically without any dropout, without any switching noise. You don't really notice it. I didn't even have to select wireless channels manually once. It just worked flawlessly all the time. I also used the system in an outdoor setting, and I used the system combined or in parallel with other wireless microphones and wireless in-ear systems, and like I said, with wireless routers in the room, and there were no interference problems, no problems whatsoever. I've not done a range test on these. People often like to do range tests with wireless systems. To me, that's almost pointless because I'm not trying to wander 50 meters away from the stage. I didn't have any range issues. Shure says this system has 30 meters of wireless range, which would be plenty for me. One thing that I was a little bit worried about was noise, because the in-ear systems we use at church, for example, do have plenty of noise. Now, the wireless systems for in-ears are typically on another frequency range. It's not this Wi-Fi frequency band. So this might be a different story, but I can definitely say this unit doesn't have any noticeable noise. Also, there's no noticeable lag or latency. I have used wireless in-ear systems, for example, that had noticeable lag, and I absolutely can't stand lag. For example, I've also played my guitar into interfaces with input lag, and I've always hated it. I feel like I'm quite sensitive to that. So I'm really happy that this unit doesn't have any input latency, or at least no noticeable latency. So no noise, no input lag, at least nothing noticeable. A very strong, reliable signal, clarity. So audio wise, the system is top notch. I'm very happy with that. And I can't tell any difference between having a cable plugged in or having this system plugged in. I can't tell a difference in latency. I can't tell a difference in noise. I can't tell a difference in clarity. It just feels like a cable. Let's quickly talk about how this unit operates. The pedal has a switch on the side that lets it switch off permanently. I'm going to switch it on. You see it shows the selected channel, channel 11. It selects that automatically, and I haven't found a need to change it manually. You can select channels manually. You can switch to tuner mode. You can use a strobe tuner or a needle tuner. I have to say, this tuner, it works quite good. It's not as exact or as precise as, for example, the Line 6 Helix built-in tuner, but you can work with this. If you have, for example, just an acoustic guitar and want to use this as a tuner, or you want to build a mini pedal board and don't want to have an extra tuner on, it works good enough. I found I still prefer to use the Line 6 Helix. I use the Helix anyway, so I can choose freely and I will stay with the Helix tuner, but it's nice to have the tuner. The pedal shows with this yellow LED in the middle that it's muted. When you switch back to non-tuner mode, you see the mute LED is not illuminating. Right next to it you have an audio LED that's here in the left. So if I play guitar a little bit, you can see it illuminates. For me that's an extremely nice and useful feature to be able to see if the system actually outputs audio. Let's say you are in a situation where for whatever reason at the board no audio is present, or you start playing and nothing is audible. So in panic you start to search for the error. It's always nice to have some kind of control, and with this LED I know if the system is outputting audio or if I need to quickly switch to a cable because there's some failure or whatever. And with one of the later Line 6 Helix updates, for example, my Helix that I'm using also has these indicators in the signal chain indicating if signal is going in and out. So I get a pretty clear idea, should there ever be no signal, if it's coming out of this wireless system, if it's going into the Helix, if there's something at the output of the Helix. So features like this are really nice and good to have as a backup. So right now also you can see I've switched on the belt pack. You can see there's a blue LED in the bottom that indicates that the belt pack is connected. And in the top we have a battery indicator. This is nicely done on this unit. On some of the cheaper units you just get one battery LED. That, for example, was one reason why I personally decided to not buy the Sennheiser guitar wireless system, because you don't really get a clear idea how much battery you have left. So having this 7 segments of LEDs gives you a much clearer idea how much battery you have left. What I don't understand though is why Shure choose to just use half of the available LEDs. They have all these LEDs used by the tuner, but for the battery indicator, for whatever reason, they just use the left half. So they could have done it more detailed, but choose not to do it. I don't understand why, but still this is way better than with other wireless guitar systems, so it's still a plus. Speaking of battery life, Shure says this system has 11.5 hours of battery life. On the Thomann website it even says it has 16 hours of battery life. I don't know which one is true. I didn't measure it. All I can tell is I used it for 2 practices, a wedding and a service, and I wouldn't even have had to recharge in the meantime. This would have lasted me easily for 2 practice sessions and 2 services. But also recharging is very fast. In like 1 hour it charges up a lot. I also quickly wanted to show you the back of this unit. It has a rubber pad in the top and 2 little rubber pads in the bottom. So on a flat surface it sits quite firmly, doesn't slide around easily. So this again is the belt pack. Like I said, all metal construction. If you open the battery compartment, you can see it has a proprietary battery. This is a very strong battery, like I said, more than 11 hours of battery use. The battery is built in a form factor that you can't put it in the wrong way. You could put it in like this with the contacts on the wrong side, but then you can't close the lid. We've had issues in our church with the wireless in-ear systems that use AA type batteries, and if you put them in the wrong direction it's hard to get them out, or they just don't work, and yeah, that can be quite annoying. So this is way more easy. Also, one thing about the battery I want to mention, there is a different type of receiver that is, I believe, called the GLXD4. This is the GLXD6. With the 4, it's more like a typical rack type receiver with antennas. The nice thing about that one is it has a compartment where you can slide in this battery and charge it directly in the receiver. The pedal unfortunately doesn't have that, and I originally wanted to buy the rack receiver for this feature. Now the reason I didn't buy it in the end is because of space on my pedalboard. I can fit this on my pedalboard. With the rack receiver, it would have been a bit more difficult. So that's why I decided to buy the pedal. I do wish though the pedal also had the slot to charge the battery. That's a really nice touch, a really nice feature, I think. And I also wish there was an external charger for the battery itself, because then you could just have two batteries and have one in the belt pack and one charging at the same time. If you have the pedal with the receiver, the way to charge it is via a USB plug on the side. And then the system includes a charger with a micro USB cable that you plug in on the side like this, and then you charge off the wall. One thing I found interesting is that on the back of the box, it says USB charge cable included and USB wall charger is optional. So judging by the box, the wall charger would not be included, but there is one included. So nice to have. The belt pack does have a little switch at the top right here and an indicator right next to it. And if I switch it on, you can see it turns green. That indicator LED can also turn red if like the battery is low or something is going on. This switch seems to be a bit flimsy if you just look at it, but it's actually, if you touch it, it doesn't really feel cheap or flimsy. And it's also located in a way right next to the antenna and the cable sitting right here, where you don't really accidentally touch it. It's also pretty flat, so you are not going to accidentally switch that off. The belt pack comes with this cable, has a golden Neutrik plug and a proprietary plug, which I don't really like. And it has a screw, can be tightened, and then you can plug this into your guitar. Also, right now, I wanted to highlight how quickly this thing connects. If you look at the indicator in the top left of the pedal, I switch it on and it's connected. Once the belt pack is connected to the receiver, you can also adjust the gain for the belt pack on the pedal. You do that by pressing the mode button on the pedal, and now you can use the arrow keys to adjust up or down. Now you can see I have it on plus 1 dB. I did that to match my cable input, so in case I have to ever switch back to plugging a cable directly to my Helix, I have the same level, and I found it to be pretty much the same at plus 1 dB. One thing that is nice is if you use multiple belt packs with the pedal, you can adjust the gain per belt pack. So let's say you have one guitar with more output and one guitar with weaker output, you can adjust your belt packs and have adjusted gain settings for each guitar. I'm pretty much just using one guitar, so that's not a use case for me, but it's still nice to have, and it's a sign of a professional system that they thought of including features like that. Now I've highlighted a lot of the things I really like about the system. There are also a few things I dislike, and I don't want to hide them from you. So one of the things I don't like is regarding build quality on the belt pack. Overall, the belt pack is very solid build, but the antenna itself, there is a little wobble. There's a little bit of play for a unit that's otherwise built so solid. That's a detail that's kind of negative. It's not too bad, probably won't break, but yeah, it's a little detail that sticks out negatively in the otherwise so good build quality. The other thing in the build quality is this little rubber that you can pull out to reveal the USB port and also a link button. Now it's nice that it has this cover, but the thing is it doesn't really easily go back in.
Two hours later.
Now I don't know if that's just an issue with my particular unit, maybe in that outdoor service some dirt got inside the rubber openings, but yeah, that's not so nice. The other thing that I don't quite like is this cable. First of all, I don't like the proprietary connector, because if this cable breaks down, I can't use this unit. I need to buy another replacement cable. For me, it would have been way better to just use a normal plug. Now, the reasoning behind using this plug is so that you can have this screw and screw it on. And that way, at least that's the reasoning, even if this falls off your belt, it will keep hanging off the cable and not accidentally unplug. I get that reason. I still would prefer a normal non-proprietary plug, or to use a type of plug where you have this kind of screw, but still use a normal plug combined with it. There are, for example, headphones that are like that. For example, on these headphones, they have a normal 3.5 millimeter plug, but it also has a thread for screws, so you can screw on a headphone adapter. But you can still use this with a headphone adapter that doesn't have this thread, just sticking it on without screwing. So I would have wished that Shure would have used a normal plug combined with a screw, or just a normal plug, so I'm not forced to use this proprietary cable. For that reason, I will probably buy a replacement or a spare cable just to have it, just in case. One other thing I don't like about this cable is, I don't know if that's visible on camera, but the actual tip and sleeve of the plug is not straight with the housing. It's a little bit bent. That's probably just my particular unit, but still, for a system at that price point, that's not so great. I probably will get a replacement cable anyways to have it as a spare, so that's also not so bad for me. So yeah, those were some of the pain points on the system. Overall, I really like it. It's a bit pricey, but I think the reliability, the clarity, no lag, the battery lifetime, the features that just make the system reliable. You know you can count on it. You don't have to be on stage having to worry if your wireless system will drop out. I think that's worth the price, and that's why I think this is the most reliable and also the best value for money system you can buy. Because in my mind, even if I spend half of the price, let's say I spend $200 instead of $400, and I have a system that works overall good, but some of the time has dropouts and some of the time I have to worry about battery, I'm actually not having more fun or more freedom using a wireless system, but I have an extra headache and I would probably be better off just using a cable. That's why for me it's not really worth investing a lower price point but having a less reliable system. If I go wireless, I want it to be reliable, and that's why I opted for this system, and that's why for me it's worth the money. So that wraps up today's video. I hope you got value out of this video. Press like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to see more content like this, and I'm excited to see all of you in the next one. Bye.